Well, hello. How are you?
I'm good. Nice to officially meet you. My name is Sam here at 97X.
Hi, Sam. Where is 97X? What city is this?
We're Tampa.
Oh, I should have known such a thing.
Yeah. It's all good. It's all good. You at Angels and Airwaves actually played. We do 97X Next Big Thing. That's our big festival at the end of the year. You guys played at, I think, 06 and 07, maybe?
Wow.
Yeah.
I was like, that's crazy. There was a time where 06 and 07 felt like it wasn't that long ago. And then all of a sudden now that's like 15 years ago. That's wild.
And yeah. We were saying 2020 felt like the future when we'd have flying cars, but here we are.
They've been saying that shit since I was in like second grade. I remember my teacher saying that in second grade. When you're 18, he said this, when you're 18, you will have flying cars. And I looked at him, you son of a bitch, you better be right, you know.
Nope. Instead, we are hoarding toilet paper and, you know, watching Netflix.
Yeah, same thing. It's the same thing. It's what we choose to do with our technology, you know?
Yeah. Yeah. So tell me about your, I know I kind of always like to go through what's this situation been like for you? Everybody's kind of got a different perspective. Where are you?
I'm in San Diego. I don't have much to complain about because the weather's really good here. And you know, we didn't get hit too hard in San Diego. I mean, out of California, I think we got hit the second hardest or something, but that's, you know, in a city of 3 million people or whatever it is, there's like 1300 people that are reported on. So it's not like New York. It's not like Italy that you hear about, but LA is has it way worse. I even hear San Francisco maybe, but I don't know. This is me thinking out loud. We're okay. You know, we're okay. I think everyone right now is just bored. I got kids that are like ready to burn the place down. You know, that's more of a threat, I think.
Yeah, I think that stir crazy sense is kind of everywhere right now. Here in Florida, we've started reopening stuff, which is a whole nother kind of weird because they've got restaurants at like 25% capacity and people are like, just so excited to go out. I'm a little more hesitant because I still come to the station every day and I'm trying to be like safe so that I can continue to do that.
Wait, so they open up restaurants there?
25% capacity and then you can sit outside 6 feet apart.
Well, I might have to come over there for some 6 feet apart table service.
I know. Don't you miss like the free bread basket or some free chips and salsa?
Do you think that they're going to open up like at what phase, you know, prostitution will be opened up? Is that against social distancing or is that like, is that illegal? No, it's not. It's legal in like Vegas and shit. That's probably like phase 9.
Yeah. You know, at this point, I don't think anyone knows what to expect anymore.
Yeah. I don't know when they're going to open up restaurants and stuff here. Like, I don't even know. California governor is rightfully conservative. I wouldn't want to make the decision where like you made a decision and 30 days later, an extra 150,000 people die. You know, you're like, you don't want to be that guy, you know?
No, no. They're all doing things differently. All you can do is watch out for yourself and do the best you can. I think at this point, it's hard to even know what the next thing is going to be, the next move. But
yeah.
But anyway, I mean, I don't know. At least we have new music from Angels and Airwaves to talk about.
Wild. Yeah.
So, yeah. And, you know, I want to talk about first what you just released, All That's Left Is Love, and how timely it is. Like, even the lyrics to that song kind of seem like they're just perfect with what's going on right now. Was that intentional?
Yeah. We recorded the song already because we've been recording for like a year. And so the song was done except for the vocal track. So when I went in to sing it, actually I said, you know what, we should meet up, keep 6 feet away from me, but we should do this song and put it out and I'll change the words. And because I was inspired it came from me. And I've said this on countless other interviews. I just think an artist has we have kind of the role to try and cheer people up and get their thinking differently. Cause that's probably the best support you can give people outside of if we can't give them money to pay their rent or give them food to help their families. I mean, this kind of helped in some respects because we put it out with Feeding America, which I've done multiple times. I've gone to their big events. I've donated stuff for charity to raise money. I've given food to impoverished families. I've passed out food on the holidays and stuff. My daughter has done work in their warehouse. You know, like, we've been involved with Feeding America, this family, for a long time. And so it was really simple to work with the San Diego chapter and just call them up and say, dude, we should do this together or whatever. But my primary goal, though, was just to start getting people out of that kind of cyclical negative thing that we all get in by reading the news all day, and everyone's got anxiety and everyone's fearful, and no one knows what to believe, no one knows who to believe, you know. So I just wanted to do my part there.
Well, it definitely is an interesting time to release music, in that I think you're actually at an advantage, because everybody's home and they're looking for this stuff to consume. They're looking for new things to do. And when you release something like that and it's topical, it's relatable, I think it makes perfect sense. Do you think rest of the album will change at all given what's going on, or is it pretty much ready to go?
No, I don't think it's going to change. I just think it's giving me more time to make it better. Because it was almost done. And so now it's like, okay, there's no touring this year. So I can kind of take my time and just make these things that I did even that much better. Like the other day, I was like, this one song is so fucking good, but it can be better. I think I need to try something different on these sections. And I did. And it just, like, it made it one of the better songs of my entire career. And I was like, oh my God, like, just a little bit more effort when you least expect it sometimes with art pushes it so much further. So I think overall the record, I've been telling people that I feel like this is one of the best records, if not the best album of my life so far. But having this extra time is really getting it across the finish line, giving me like a little bit less stress just to like finish it and get it out, because we have to have a record out by here. I've got a tour by here. You know, it's like, all right, I have more time because I'm forced to. So,
yeah, that whole timeline for artists now is just kind of messed up, because there is normally a big promotion where it's like, you're gonna announce the tour dates, you're gonna release your first single, and now it's kind of like up in the air with I mean, nobody knows when touring will go back to the way we love it and know it.
I know, right? I don't know, that's why my joke about prostitution, it's just I'm just like, because it's like we can't be around each other at all, you know. It's can't go to a concert, you can't go to a sports game, you can barely go to a restaurant. And now all the grocery stores, everything have like plastic in between everything. Have you seen that yet at grocery stores?
Yeah, our grocery stores here are like that, yeah.
They're in spacesuits, like Apollo. So I don't know. I mean, it's like contact is, it makes you miss it. It makes you miss each other, I guess, is something worth writing a song about.
Definitely. And you guys had kind of, last year was a real ramp up for you, kind of diving back into touring. I mean, I saw you were selling out shows like back to back, like within minutes of them going on sale.
We're important. We're super important. Yeah.
So was it kind of like a little bit of a letdown to kind of come off like such a great round of touring, and then all this starts happening and you're like, oh, dang it.
No, because the truth is that you need a little bit of space. You don't, you know, you want people to want it, you know. You don't need to like hit them so many times in a row. And then there's a little bit of like, oh, I just saw them 6 months ago. You know, I think it works to our benefit to do something really well, and then they have to wait a little bit longer for it to remind them that they might be excited to see it later. I mean, it's kind of like, you know, you put out a big Star Wars movie and then they put one out like 11 months later. You're like, okay, like, you know, but you're not dying to see it. But if they waited 3 or 4 years, you would be like, are you going? I'm going, you know? So we won't wait that long, but I think it helps us out. I think it, you know, what that tour was really about is that the band is back in the public eye, and it's my priority for the first time in a really long time, music. You know, and I've been working on so much other stuff. I took a little bit of a hiatus because I haven't been touring with anyone, but I have been putting out music with Angels and Airwaves, but under the radar, you know. So this is the way we're doing it now was much more like, you know, it's much more of it's a business, it's a mission, it's priority, it's competitive, you know. Mm-hmm.
What was the moment? I mean, you talk about how you did take, you know, there was a big kind of break there. I think 2014 was the last album that you guys had.
I don't know. Maybe.
I think it was 2014.
Probably. I mean, I don't know. Because we put out like 4 or 5 EPs. We put out a double album. We put out the Dreamwalker album.
Yeah, that's what I'm thinking of.
I don't think it was 2014, though, was it? It could be 6 years ago. It had to have been like 4 years ago. Was that 4 years ago? Was it 2016? Is that what you said?
I said 14, but I could be wrong.
I was like, it had to be like 4 years ago. And then you said 2016. I was like, God, my math is getting horrid. You know what's really bad? Is my writing, my penmanship is the worst. Because we only type now. Yeah. So if you have to write something, it just looks like it's illegible. It's great. Doctors are like, whoa, that's the worst I've ever seen. You know, doctors write really bad.
Yeah. Well, they don't even teach kids like cursive anymore. Cause it's like, why? We don't even really have to write things out for people.
But they teach kids like algebra and calculus because that's important. I don't even remember long division. If you put long division in front of me right now, I don't know. I forgot it, you know, all those years of doing it. And the only thing I remember in school were like 4 things. Like, I don't remember any of the history, any of the physics. I remember a little bit of the science stuff because I thought it was interesting. But it's like, it's, we should be teaching kids like how to grow their own food.
Do
your taxes. But I think like, how do you take care of the earth? You know, how do you create things that you don't pollute? How do you grow your own food? How do you treat people better? How do you know more about yourself? They're all, no, you have to learn about this dude in France that carried a bucket and let someone know that England was coming to France. You're like, wait, what? You know, there's just things that, look at me. Yeah. I should be Secretary of Education. Yeah, it's my new thing.
I think I vividly remember so many hissy fits I threw at my dining room table with my math book. Like, I should have space in my brain for something other than remembering how much I cried over my math homework.
I know.
And I'm in an industry now that's like about numbers and the length of songs and doing quick math. But that stuff I learned then, I never use that now.
Never use it. Yeah. It's just, I don't know. And know what the worst thing is too? Now the kids are doing homeschool. They're on the computer for literally like 2 hours and then they're like done. What the fuck are you at school for 8 hours a day for when you only, they're getting it all done in 2 hours. It's wild. It's just
that's
like,
crazy.
It's like the shit that really matters. They don't talk. They don't make jokes. They don't yell at the kids. They just kind of like, these are the chapters. Here's the questions. You're off. Go. Get away from me, kid.
And now that you don't even have to get out of your pajamas for it. I mean,
I know.
I'm jealous.
I know, right? They're all comfortable all day long. I know. It's like, you got to wear a suit.
Yeah, no.
I
can wear what I want. Today, I tried a little harder because I knew. But most days, I just wear hoodies.
Okay.
There's no one here. Like, in the office, it's just honor people, and then everyone else works from home. So it's kind of like a very ghostly feeling in the studio now.
Yeah, but sometimes you just got to, like, at least kind of dress up just because you're leaving. You're like, I got to act like I care about me.
I got to make sure my jeans still fit, like, at least once a week.
We're all cooking, like, 8 meals a day and shit.
Yeah.
Well, I think tonight is pasta, and then tomorrow is pasta.
Because why not?
I know.
Well, I mean, it's definitely an interesting time. And, I mean, how are you finding that balance? Because, like you said, you took such a huge time, and you have a massive other project. I mean, I just read, you know, it was just in the news recently, you're getting acknowledged by like the Navy, and like, it's so cool to watch the projects you're working on outside of music develop. How are you keeping that balance and keeping tabs on, and now being homeschool dad?
I don't know. Like, right before this call, I was a couple minutes late because I was on a board call all about artificial intelligence, right? So I'm sitting here talking about all this stuff that I really know very little about, but I have concepts on it or whatever. And then like, it turns off and I got to jump into this mode. Okay, wait, I'm a musician, you know? I get a lot of credit for things that I don't do. Like, you know, I have a bunch of government partners and we have a bunch of people who work at the company, and we got a lot of really smart team, you know? So every time we do something, like getting the Pentagon to finally publish the videos. And last year I got the US Navy to admit that UFOs are actually real, you know, but these are like this is took 3 years, and it took members from the CIA and the Department of Defense and other agencies that we all came together and everyone did their part, you know? And then people kind of grab my name because I'm at the forefront, but really what it took to achieve this was massive. Like it started with the videos coming out on the New York Times and all about Lou that ran the program. And then it went into our show on the History Channel that documented when we were actually getting senators briefed and bringing out all the military pilots to brief the Senate and the Congress. And then it took us setting up members from the UFO program at the Pentagon to bring those people out and brief the senators. And for the first time, kind of leapfrogging over a bunch of middle management guys that have been hiding this for 70 years. And then we did all of that. And then the public pressure started and we stayed on it, you know, we stayed on it. And we had to be very careful because we couldn't, like, you know, we had to make sure that we didn't fuck up anything that had national security implications. We couldn't out classified programs. But at the same time, we needed to educate people. We needed to educate Congress and congressmen for the first time. And then we also needed, you know, we had a lot of input and advice, and we were involved in crafting things that would help national security policy on this issue, creating formal reporting mechanisms that go all the way up to our elected officials, not just to somebody that runs the cool program, you know. So there's a lot of these things were taking place, and those specific things weren't me. It'd be like Chris Mellon, who's the chairman of my scientific advisory board. I mean, Chris Mellon's like, he was the first Undersecretary of Defense for Intelligence. It's like the third in command of the Pentagon, you know, and he wrote the Joint Special Operations Command bill, which is a complete restructuring of our military system and how it works and all that. I mean, he's a big time guy, you know, and his connections from working on the Senate Intelligence Committee and working in the Department of Defense and Intelligence. And he's the shark swimming around over in DC while we're out here doing the stuff on the media, and I'm putting the stuff together to get it funded and get the company off the ground, you know, and get the show on television or whatever. It's like everyone's doing their part. I guess this is me thinking out loud, but I get a lot of credit for it. I was just, you know, the reality of it was I did something that initially got me into a lot of trouble with certain people in certain places in the government. And then I think they found out that I was trying to help and I had a way to help. And then these new people came around, gathered around me and said, there's a better way to do this. And here's the overall strategy. And we all had a big part in that. So I kind of, you know, they like to tell me, they always say, you know, some people say you let off a grenade in a China shop or something. It's like an expression. They say you let off a grenade in a punch bowl, you know, and they're all, so what you did was insane, but it worked because now look at the path we're on, that we always say the genie's out of the bottle. The people in the government know, you know, they know that this is real. They've been lied to and there's some major, major stuff there. And now you can't stop it. Like, we put this into motion. And so I keep telling people, as much as it was fun to think Tom was crazy and left his band to chase aliens or whatever, I was laughing. I was like, you guys have no idea what I'm involved in and what I know and what I've been briefed on and what my guys know. And it's coming and people need to brace themselves. And there's some negative things about it. And it's going to be hard to digest for some people, but then there's some really good things about it, you know? And so it's, you know, but then you look at stuff like the pandemic and go, gosh, look what people do when they get scared.
Yeah.
You know, so it's super, super important that we trust our leaders, that we like them and think they're smart and intelligent and make good decisions. And that was part of my pitch years ago. I mean, long before Trump was in office, I was pitching you guys, we need you to start talking to young people because they do not trust you. And they're very cynical about you and what you do, you know, so let me help you with that. Because I do know what you're up against and it's gnarly. It's like a big deal, you know, you need people's support, you know, so.
It's definitely, you know, it's beyond interesting to follow and to see the developments happen. And I just always have felt that it feels special for us to have you at the forefront of something like that. Because, I mean, like I said before, you played our show with Angels and Airwaves in 2006. Before that, I mean, we've been playing Blink-182 since you guys started. So you've kind of been a part of our family for a long time in the alternative music world, and it's just kind of fun to feel like you're at the forefront of so cool, and it's fun to follow. And staying educated is so important. I remember my dad used to tell me growing up, like, if you do anything, Sam, just pay attention. Pay attention to what's going on in the world. Don't, you know, don't get involved in yourself to a point where you lose track of what's happening. So I think it's, it, like you said, it's a cool wake-up call for people to just kind of, you know, stay attentive to what's happening, and you're kind of helping us do that. So
I'm trying. I appreciate you saying that. You know, I think the one benefit of me being the person that, and I see that, I see the jokes and stuff. It's funny. Like, I saw this thing, I literally laughed so hard. I don't laugh that often. I laugh a lot, but it's gotta be like absurd, you know? And I laughed out loud when I saw this Stephen Colbert had this thing where he's like, as recently the guy from Blink-182, this is a couple weeks ago, you know, guy from Blink-182, got the Pentagon to officially publish the videos, admit UFOs are real, And he's also, he said something like, so I look forward to getting all of my updates on North Korea missile defense from Smash Mouth, you know, another band in the 90s, you know. The way he said it, though, was so funny that the government's using 90s bands to talk to, you know. Yeah. And I just thought that was the funniest shit. And I get how absurd that is, you know. It's like, it makes no sense. I ask myself, like, you know, what would it be if Billy Joe from Green Day was talking to us all about cloning, and he's busting out cloning that the U.S. government's been, you know, we'd be like, wait, what? You know, like, where does that come from? But for me, I've always been into space. I've always been into consciousness. I've always been into who are we, where are we from? Long before my band was ever popular, I was studying this stuff. You know, obviously there's early Blink songs about UFOs and aliens and stuff, you know, but, you know, I only had two big passions, and that was one was music and that. And, but I've always been an entrepreneur. You know, I was always building companies on the side. Blink always did that. So when I had the opportunity, when I stopped playing music, like professionally, I made an entertainment company, To the Stars. It was just like a science fiction Disney. We're going to come up with stories that are informed science fiction, and we're a publisher, production studio, merchandiser. We just do it all. And one day some of these will get bigger and it'll be fun. And Angels and Airwaves is a part of it. You know, our music will be coupled with these things, and it's more of a big, huge art project. That's all this was. Well, one of the informed stories was about UFOs, but I realized I would get into a lot of hot water if I didn't go ask permission before I did this particular story. Well, I did go ask permission, and I made my way into some very important places, and they liked what I had to say, you know, and now we're here. So it just took, you know, but I had to execute. I had to be humble about it. I had to be respectful. I had to really earn trust and prove that I would do what I said I would do. And that's so when they said, okay, you're the guy, let's do this, it was like, okay, well, I'm going to be like, people are going to throw arrows and shoot at me, throw rocks at me for like the next few years because they will not get it. But I'm signing up for it because, oh my God, I can't believe the company I keep. I cannot believe what I have access to and how, where I get to sit. It's like beyond fascinating. It is so cool and so different. And so it's just, you know, something that nobody else knows, you know, and you look around and the whole world's different to me than it would be for you or anybody else. I go to like the beach and I see thousands of people. I go, man, these people, they have no idea what's going on. They have no idea. And when they find out, they're going to freak the fuck out. But that's where I step in and go, well, that's my job. My job here is to make that easier, that transition easier. And that's what I'm focused on.
Well, we're ready for it. We're excited about everything you're doing and the album too. I mean, I've listened to Kiss and Tell, and we love Rebel Girl. It just seems like, you know, a different texture completely. Like, they're like different. Each song sounds different, which I really like.
Thank you.
So we're here for everything you're doing, and we're excited about what's to come. And hopefully, maybe you can come play 97X next week, being a third time.
Hey, I'm down. You guys just got to put me in a big plastic suit so I don't get sick. Well, I got so sick on my last tour, and it wasn't even COVID. I was just like, I lost my voice, and I was like, God, it's horrible.
The show's not till November, December, usually, so we're kind of in this, like, holding pattern, waiting to see what happens. But maybe we will all be in like spacesuits. I'm here for it. I'm fine.
Yeah. I just want a spacesuit that's big enough for two people. Because it gets boring, you know, if you're like locked in, but then someone put one of my band members in there with me, like David, he's tall too, so his face is pressed against my face inside of one suit. What do you think about that?
Yeah, I don't think anyone's doing that. So,
yeah, it's new. I'm always doing new stuff. I'm doing new stuff.
Well, thank you so much for talking with us. This was awesome. And yeah, we're here for you and what you're doing right now. And we just really appreciate it.
Thank you so much.
And stay safe in the quarantine.
I am trying to. Yes. All right. Bye-bye.
All right. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.